Blackstone Audio presents The Politically Incorrect Guide to the Presidents, Part 1, From Washington to Taft, by Larry Schweikart. This book is read by John McLain. To Jeff Head, Freeper and Friend. Introduction. What did the founders have in mind? The executive power shall be vested in a President of the United States of America. He shall hold his office during the term of 4 years. The President shall be Commander-in-Chief of the Army and Navy of the United States and of the Militia of the several states. He shall from time to time give to the Congress information of the State of the Union and recommend to their consideration. United States Constitution, Article 2, Sections 1, 2, and 3. What does it mean to be the President of the United States? We know, of course, what the office has become over time. Head of American Public Relations, advocate for his political party, singular voice of the most powerful nation in the world, quasi-royalty in a nation that has shunned aristocracy and titles, top dog, big cheese, head honcho. Asking modern Americans who the President is, or what the President does, would elicit responses from the astute to the utterly insane. Very few answers would contain the terms chief executive, commander-in-chief, or head of state. These are terms from long ago, in a galaxy far away from the experiences of mass media and pop culture in 21st century America. Before the devolution. No one in particular is to blame for the evolution, some might say the devolution, of the presidency into the hashtag-issuing, saxophone and basketball-playing, golfing, jogging suit-wearing, executive order-issuing equivalent of a Hollywood movie studio or a Fortune 500 company. Like most changes in American politics, this transformation has occurred slowly, a step at a time, and seldom with any formal discussion, let alone the approval of either Congress or the American people as a whole. Rather, as the old saying goes, silence gives consent. The modern presidents are no more to blame for the relentless aggrandizement of executive power than are the Congresses and courts that meekly handed ever more control to them, or the people themselves who timidly stood by as their ability to control their circumstances diminished. But what was the presidency before this transformation, as it unfolded from 1789 until 1912? With few exceptions, we would find a much different office, occupied by a set of men who, even in the worst of cases, had a view of their powers and responsibilities that is very different from the office as it exists today. It goes without saying that attitudes have changed, and it is not within the scope of this book to argue whether the expansion of federal executive power changed the attitudes, or whether the transformed views of what was acceptable paved the way for the inhabitants of the most important office in the world to take more control. What there is no debate about, on left or right, is that the position filled by George Washington, James K. Polk, Rutherford B. Hayes, and even William Howard Taft shared little with the presidential office of those who came later, particularly after the Great Depression and World War II. Whether that growth was entirely, or even mostly, as Robert Higgs argues in Crisis and Leviathan, the result of crises, there is little doubt that crises do present almost irresistible opportunities for governments to grow, and specifically for presidents to use their powers in new, and often perversely, imaginative ways. Rahm Emanuel, former chief of staff to President Barack Obama, notoriously said, "You never want a serious crisis to go to waste, and what I mean by that is, it's an opportunity to do things you think you could not do before." Who thinks like that? Many politicians today, perhaps. But for well over 100 years from the time the nation was founded, no president viewed his office in terms of doing things he could not do before. Quite the contrary. Before the 20th century, not even the worst presidents ever deliberately attempted to pervert or alter the parameters and restrictions of their constitutionally defined powers. For all the accusations of his critics, Abraham Lincoln constantly fretted about whether what he was doing during the Civil War was permitted constitutionally. He frequently admitted he didn't know, saying it was up to the people to interpret his actions as either within or outside of the Constitution through elections. His opponents raged that the people could not judge, that it was up to either the Supreme Court, in the case of ex-party Merryman, or Congress to determine what was constitutional. Of course, in the 21st century, when the U.S. Supreme Court under Chief Justice John Roberts ruled Obamacare constitutional, critics of the president's policies made just the opposite argument, insisting that the court did not have the right of judicial review. A book you're not supposed to read. Crisis and Leviathan, Critical Episodes in the Growth of American Government, 25th Anniversary Edition, by Robert Higgs, Oakland, California, The Independent Institute, 2012. Given that the modern presidency has become far more than the founders ever expected or intended, and that its influence has been vastly expanded beyond its official powers, it is a fascinating fact that in almost any poll or survey of the best or most important presidents, two of the top three or four are always George Washington and Abraham Lincoln, while Thomas Jefferson, Andrew Jackson, and Theodore Roosevelt often appear in the top 10. If conservatives are asked to list the best presidents, Grover Cleveland, Martin Van Buren, and William McKinley often join them. Despite the persistent tendency to list the more recent chief executives, reverence, respect, and disproportionate preference for those who held the position more than 100 years ago remain. Why would that be, if the modern presidency is what the people want? Perhaps the reason is that despite their inclination to, as Stephen Hayward put it in the politically incorrect guide to the presidents from Wilson to Obama, see the president as some kind of miracle worker, the public still has an appreciation for the concept of limited and restrained powers, even if it doesn't always want to see those limits in action. The sobering fact is that since at least World War II, neither Congresses nor Supreme Courts have proven themselves worthy adversaries in the checks and balance system. This is not to blame Congress and the court, but to acknowledge that nature abhors a vacuum, especially in leadership. The reality is that as technology has made the world smaller, the reaction time to changes in international situations, here I refuse to employ the term crisis to characterize daily events, necessarily means that smaller groups, such as a president and his staff, make the decisions. While House and Senate members debate and talk.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.